Good morning, everybody. In today's session, you'll be studying about aquifers, aquitrachs, aquicludes, and what are scarcity which is occurring in the world, and water balance equation. And then you'll be studying about groundwater availability in the world and groundwater table. And before starting with the topics, let's discuss some of the points what we have discussed in the last classes, that is divisions of subsurface water. Here in the case of subsurface water, it has been divided into two zones. One is zone of aeration and then another is zone of saturation. In case of zone of aeration, it is again divided into three subdivisions. One is soil water zone, intermediate zone, capillary zone. Now we'll go for aquifers. The formation which contains groundwater at the same time which is sufficient permeable to transmit and yield water in usable quantities are called as aquifers. This may get recharged directly above through the process of precipitation and infiltration, or they may have a recharge areas somewhere on the earth's surface. The amount of water contained by the formation, while the amount of water that it can yield depends upon the permeability. Further, this aquifer are classified into two types. One is unconfined aquifers and then confined aquifers. Unconfined aquifers are also called as free aquifer or water table aquifer, wherein water flows freely and the water table tends to approximate the topography of the landscape. In case of confined aquifer, it is also called as artesian aquifer, in which water flow is restricted by impermeable layer called as aquicludes. Their presence can have two consequences. Over here you can see a permeable rock that holds the water over here. This is your aquifer. And in this diagram you can see various types of aquifers. One is confined aquifers and unconfined aquifers, semi-confined aquifers, aquitrachs, aquicludes, and flowing artesian wells and non-artesian wells. This one is your water table here you can see. So first we'll go for confined aquifers. An aquifer having a water table in it is called as unconfined aquifer. For this aquifer, the water table serves as an upper surface of zone of saturation, while a less permeable or impermeable layer defines its lower boundary. The permeable layer underlying an unconfined aquifer may be clay, shale, limestone, igneous rock, any bed rocks. The unconfined aquifers is also called as free aquifers, phreatic aquifer, water table aquifer, or non-artesian aquifers. Over here in this diagram you can see this one is an permeable zone. Over here this might be your impermeable zone, wherein the water can get percolated and it is going to be collected, and there is no way out for this water. Only this water can be collected using pumps. The water table in an unconfined aquifer undulating and depends on an area of recharge and discharge from well and its permeability. A well driven in an unconfined aquifer is static water level corresponding to the water table at that location. Next we'll go for confined aquifers. When an aquifer is sandwiched between the two layers of much permeable or much less permeable material, then it is called as confined aquifer. Example, a sandy layer between two clay layers or a sandstone layer between two layers of shale. It is also known as pressure aquifer or an artesian aquifer. Confined aquifers are completely filled with water and they do not have any free water table. This will have recharge area somewhere on the earth's surface. The water in the confined aquifers will be under pressure, and the pressure condition in an aquifer is indicated by the piezometric surface, which is the free obtained by connecting equilibrium water level in the tubes or piezometer penetrating the confined aquifer. If a well penetrates into the confined aquifer, the water level in the well will rise to piezometric head or artesian head. If the piezometric surface is above the ground level at the place of the well, the confined aquifer will yield a free flowing well. If, however, the piezometric surface in the well is below the groundwater and well above the local water table, then it is called as artesian well. Over here you can see, this is artesian well, and a well penetrating into an unconfined aquifer is called as water table well. This is about aquifers and types of aquifers. So in this drawing you can see, this is your layer wherein the water can penetrate through the soil strata using infiltration or percolation, and this layer is an impermeable layer wherein aquitrachs and aquiclutes are formed. This is called as unconfined aquifers. And in the next diagram you can see over here, this is confined aquifers. It is a sandwich between two layers, one layer and this one is another layer, wherein the water, once it is infiltrated, it cannot go either from these two layers. Only this water can be extracted through the wells. Next we'll go for aquitrachs. It is a saturated geological formation which is poorly permeable and hence does not yield water freely to the well. Example, sandy clay. It is a zone within the earth that resists the flow of water from one aquifer to the another aquifer. And next we'll go for aquiclutes. Aquiclutes is a geological formation which is saturated and which may contain large amount of water because of its high porosity, but can't transport water as it is relatively impermeable. It is called as aquiclute. Example, a clay layer. Next we'll go for aquifuge. What is aquifuge? It is an impervious geological formation which neither contains nor transmit water, is known as aquifuge. Example, granite or solid rock. Next we'll know how the water table can change, means how the water level in the water table rises and how it is going to low. The water table level rises with the heavy rainfall, as the water percolation will be more and recharge will be more. And if there is no water is going to be removed from the water table, then the water table level will be more. It is going to lower when there is a drought condition or because of any human activities, we are going to pump the water from the groundwater table. Next, we'll go for how this groundwater is being removed by the humans. It is mainly due to the bore wells or wells. Here, well can be drilled into an aquifer to remove the water using pump. Here you can see this is your discharge. Water is going to be discharged. And this one is the elevation what we are going to provide. In this figure you can see this is your casing and inside that one is a rising pipe. This is your aquifer and this line indicates your water table and this one is your submersible pump and this is your perforated screening. Once it is being drilled, the water is going to raise in the perforated or screening casing and then it is going to raise and the water is being discharged over here. Next, we'll see what happens if we are going to pump the water continuously. See here in this figure, you can see in the before if we have pumped the water, this is the water level. And if we continuously pump the water, then there will be a declination in the formation of water level. This one, this is called as cone of depression. And this is your lowered water level. This causes drought. And over here, in this figure, you can see this is the fresh groundwater and the ocean over here. Due to the continuous pumping of the water, then what happens? The salt groundwater, it is going to rise and then it is going to mix up with the well water. This is called as seawater intrusion. Next, we'll go for flow of groundwater. Here, the mechanism of flow in the porous medium is going to be explained mathematically as velocity is equal to hydraulic conductivity and hydraulic gradient. Here, hydraulic gradient I is nothing but the total head and the total distance. This equation is also called as Darcy's law. Next, we'll go for water balance. The water balance equation can be used to describe the flow of water in and out of the system. A water balance can be in any area of an earth surface by calculating the total precipitation input and the total of various outputs. The water balance approach always allows an examination of an hydrological cycle for any period of time. The purpose of water balance is to describe the various ways in which the water supply is expended. The water balance is a method by which we can account for an hydrological cycle of a specific area with emphasis on plants and soil moisture. Generally, the water balance equation is P is equal to Q plus E plus delta S, wherein P is a precipitation, Q is a runoff, E is an evapotranspiration, delta S is a change in storage. Nothing but the amount of inflow is equal to outflow. Here, outflow is runoff and evapotranspiration and change in the storage is delta S. This can also be written as P minus R minus G minus E minus T is equal to delta S, wherein P is a precipitation, R is a surface runoff, G is an infiltration, E is evaporation and T is a transpiration. This can also be written as P minus R minus G minus E minus T is equal to delta S, wherein P is a precipitation, R is a surface runoff, G is an infiltration, E is evaporation, and T is a transpiration. The water balance equation can be accessed for any areas and for any period of time. So here in the water balance method have four characteristic features. One is a water balance can be expressed for any subsystem of an hydrological cycle for any size of area and for any period of time. And another is a water balance can serve to calculate one unknown of the balance equation provided that the other components are known with accurate number. Over here in this equation, if I know all the elements and if I want to calculate this delta storage, it can be calculated easily. Next is the water balance can serve to check whether all the flow and storage components involved have been considered quantitatively. And a water balance can be regarded as a model of the complete hydrological process under study, which means it can be used to predict what effect the changes imposed on certain component will have on the other components of the system or subsystem. This is about water balance. Next, we'll go for water scarcity. Water scarcity is either the lack of enough water or quantity of water or lack of access to safe water, that is quality of water. It currently affects around 2.8 billion people around the world on all continents. At least 1 month out of every year and more than 1.2 billion people lack the access to clean drinking water. The world water resources are rapidly running dry, creating a global crisis for every living being on the planet. Nearly 1/6 of the world's population are already facing water shortage on the daily basis. The survey, according to FAO, that by 2025, 1.9 billion people will be living in countries or region with absolute water scarcity, and 2/3 of the water population could be under stress condition. So why this is occurring? The causes for this. Now we'll go for causes for the water scarcity. Main causes are demand and usage of water, which comes under the domestic uses, agriculture uses, and then industrial uses. Next is supply. Here there are two supplies of water. One is through surface water, another one is groundwater. In case of surface water, only 48% of rainfall ends up in the India's river, in which about 18% can be used. In case of groundwater, 82% goes to an irrigation and agriculture purpose only, and remaining 18% is divided between domestic and industrial uses. And third is climatical changes. Because of the variation of the temperature, if the temperature increases, then the amount of water requirement will be more. And another one is population. Here, because of India's population is majorly dependent on the rainfall for the production of the food crops, so major amount of water will be utilized over there itself for the agriculture purpose. Next is pollution. The polluted water seeps into the groundwater and can contaminate agricultural products which used for the irrigation. These are the major causes for the water scarcity. Next we'll go for status of groundwater in India. Here you can see the annual water availability is 1008. Here you can see the total water availability is 1869 unit, that is billion cubic meter per year. So out of that, only about 433 billion cubic meter of water will be available per year according to water and related statistic. April 2015, they have done this statistical analysis, and in this one you can see aquifers in India is only about 14 principal aquifer systems. Out of that, 42 major aquifer systems are available. Here in this, out of 42 aquifer system, majorly aquifers are present in alluvium soil, and that is about 31% of area if you are considering in India, which is made of hard and semi-consolidated rocks. Remaining area is having remaining aquifer systems. Next we'll go for groundwater resource availability. Here you can see major parts have been divided here. Here the depth of water which can be available if we are going to drill a bore. Here you can see only few areas which is been marked in the blue color will be getting less than 2 meter if you're going to drill the bore of about less than 2 meter, then we are getting a water. Only that area is very few, and remaining here you can see we have to drill so much amount of depth to extract the water. Here you can see how much amount of, because of more excavation or major pumping action, here major amount of water has been depleted, and then only few resource is remaining in these regions. Here the groundwater development in India is given in the table. The level of groundwater development here, which is considered to be safe, is 0 to 70%, which comes under this. Here you can see in 1995 it was 92%, which 92% of the districts which comes under safe zone, but in 2011 only about 71% of districts comes in the safe zone, and the remaining it has been considered as either subcritical or critical districts. And if you go for semi-critical, it is 70% to 90%. It is considered as semi-critical. Here you can see it was only 4 districts used to come under semi-critical, but in 2011 around 10% of districts in 2011 has come under semi-critical. So you can see how much amount of water has been depleted and we have come under this semi-critical. Now the similar way, critical during 1995 it was only 1% of districts was coming under critical, but in 2011 about it has been raised to 4%. Next we'll go for why this groundwater development is very much required, because you can see here the surface runoff has been depleting due to the Human activities might be or industrial usage or agriculture usage. We are in demand of this surface water and it is being used and it has been depleted. For that, what we are doing, we are excavating the groundwater and then we are using this groundwater also. If this pumping or excavation of the groundwater will be continued, then there will be a depletion in this water also, and there will be a scarcity of groundwater also. For that, we have to see to that whatever the water will be required, only that much water should be pumped, or we have to keep on recharging using many of the methods. Best example is rainwater harvesting. So by this, I'll conclude my first module, and from the next session, we'll go for second module. Thank you.